Pilate answered and said to them again, "What then do you want me to do with him who you call the King of the Jews?" So they cried out again, "Crucify him!" Then Pilate said to them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they cried out all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wanting to gratify the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and he delivered Jesus after he had scourged him to be crucified.
Son, our God is overcome. of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life?
Yeah.
moon and stars they wept. The morning sun was dead. Oh, the Savior of the world was falling. And his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon. Final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broke.
Jesus, we worship you. I know there's a lot of new faces in here that we haven't met. Like we said, welcome. I just want to share something with you real quick. I think sometimes when we come to church in this building, right, we are the church, but when we come into this building, I think sometimes we kind of get into the, we're watching a show or we're watching some production, we're watching something, and that's the farthest thing from what we try to do up here. Yeah, I know we're on a stage and we're higher and all these things, right, there's lights and loud sounds, but if I could just encourage you, the reason why all of us are up here and you're out there singing and pouring out your heart, right, is because the words are true, right? And Jesus is alive. So as we go into this last song of worship, as we go into our time of tithe and offering, I just encourage you, Jesus gave to us first, so we get to give back. And praise God that there's no obligation and there's no amount of whatever what we need to give to receive salvation, that it's a free gift. And 2,000 years ago, Jesus defeated death so that we could have that freely. Amen? Amen. So as we worship, I just encourage you, sing the words because they're true. Who gives care about what you look like? I know we're all dressed to the nines today and we're looking good and looking fresh. Dude, surrender to Jesus. Amen? That's what it's about. So we're going to surrender to Jesus this morning. Amen? Amen. We just pray over these tithes and offerings. Have your way. It's all yours, Jesus. It's not ours at all. To see your kingdom here on earth. To see your kingdom, to see the lost be given sight. We worship you, Jesus. Will the ushers come forward? Surrender.
so I can wash away my sin. And what can make me whole again?
Come on!
Nothing good beside the soul. Nothing but.
What a time we get to live in 2,000 years later, and we get to celebrate Jesus. By his blood and his resurrection, we can stand here in freedom. I know the life we can take for granted, how easy it is to take for granted even the air we breathe. But boy, do we need you, Jesus. You are all we need. You are our life. You are our love, our peace, our grace, our mercy, our gentleness, our kindness. You are our everything. So we just thank you. Can we just say thank you, Jesus, this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Jesus, we need you. You are all we need. So we worship you. We love you. We say all of these things in your holy and precious name. Amen. 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 Hey, church, why don't you guys go find someone new and greet someone this morning? Amen.
Happy Easter. Are we here to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus or what? Amen. I'm so glad you guys are here. If this is your first time here, welcome. You know, at Hosanna City Church, we exist to see people who are far from God come to know Him and make Him known. Amen. We are a family of people here, right here in town, that just come together, unified as one, and we love Jesus, and we love the Bible. So if you're new, that's what we're about. A few announcements. Actually, someone lost a phone. If that's your face, this was found in the parking lot. Come and see me. Is it yours? If this is someone else's phone, go see them. All right. You might wonder why we have a little swimming pool here. We're going to be doing some baptisms at the close of the service today. So we got a list of people that are already signed up, but that doesn't mean that if you're here and after the message you feel, hey, I've never been baptized, I want to be baptized, or I want to be baptized again, come on down. The clothes that you're in are just fine. There's nothing fancy you have to wear. We got towels. We'll dunk you right here in front of everybody. So be prepared after the service. Hang out for a while. Just stick around and worship and watch as people get baptized. Amen. A few announcements. Next week is our Connection Sunday week. The first Sunday of every month, we have potluck style set up after church out there in the foyer. We set up all the tables and chairs. We just gather together as a family and eat, and it's awesome because when you got a bunch of people to feed in your house, it's free. So you don't have to pay for it. So come around next week and be prepared. There's in the seat backs in front of you guys, we have some hard Bibles that you can use in the service today. We have some paperbacks in the back if you want to take one home. There's a few cards to check out. We have a prayer card. We love to pray for you, and God hears our prayers, and he answers our prayers. And we have many testimonies of God answering prayer. So please feel free to fill out a prayer card. Oh, thank you. I even got demonstration. That's what they look like. You can drop it in one of the boxes on the back wall. The other side, you can fill out if you're new. Fill out the Connect side. We'd love to get and connect with you, know who you are. We have an email newsletter that one of our staff members always writes an encouragement for every week. We'll send that out to you. These little green cards, you might be here because you received one. They're just great cards to have to invite people. They have all the service time, so grab some of those, put them in your wallet. And lastly, it says 8 to 15. It's on the back is a list of 15 lines that you could fill out for people that you know that you need to pray for. Write their names down, and it's just a great reminder to pray for people, to encourage people that you know, all right? We have a Life Groups video. Let's go ahead and watch that.
Praise the Lord. Happy Easter. Yes. If you're wondering what that's all about, that's our life groups. That's our midweek service. And what we do is we all meet here. We break bread together. We have a light dinner. And then we get up and worship together. And somebody exhorts us in the word. And then we all just have community together and pray with each other. It's a really sweet time. And each group does a project in the community every single quarter, which is every 3 months. So this way we're completing one of our core values, which is loving the city to life. Amen? Yeah, man, because the church is not these walls. We are the church, amen? Amen? And wherever we go, there God is, so praise the Lord. All right, today we're going to be talking about the resurrected Savior, amen? And the name of this sermon is The Wine Press of Joy, okay? And you're like, what? What does that even mean? Well, we're about to talk about it. Okay, one thing I want to get straight, first thing, First, I'm Pastor Sean Jones, if you've never met me, and I love you guys. I love to connect with you guys, so if you want to connect with me, see me after the service. I'll give you my cell number. This way I can prank call you all the time. But I also want to say, if I say, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Yes, you guys repeat, He is risen indeed, okay? I'm going to be throwing them out when I'm talking about Jesus here, and I want you guys to respond. It'll come on the screen. He is risen. Yes, praise God. Hey, man, and God is pleased that you have come this morning to seek Him out, to know Him better, to seek His face, you know. And it didn't come easy. It didn't come easy. He suffered an excruciating and painful death so that we could be connected to God. Amen? Yes. But the thing is, when I was a new believer, I used to think, and I used to weep on Good Friday, and I used to think, wow, what they did to my Lord. And yes, it is hard, and it is a heavy thing. And if you've ever seen Mel Gibson's movie, you know you have a little taste of that. It's probably 100,000 times worse than that, because there was metaphysical and psychological suffering that was going on too with Jesus, as he was spat on and ridiculed and denied his character as God, as he set aside himself as God so that he could endure suffering as a man. Amen? And so it didn't come easy, but then I realized as I grew in with the Lord that it was for His joy that He was a sacrifice for us, that He was the perfect and spotless Lamb of God, amen? Yes, it was for the joy that was set before Him. He endured the cross, despising His shame, and sat down at the right hand in the throne room of God. Praise the Lord. And it actually pleased Him, and it pleased the Father that He would endure suffering so that we could be connected to Him. So let's just open in prayer here that we might have discernment, because discernment is only by the power of the Holy Spirit in us. Amen? Father, we just thank You. We thank You for this morning, and we thank You that You have sent Your Son. And Jesus, we thank You for coming and laying down Your life for us, Lord, and taking it back up, God, that You didn't stay in that grave, Lord, that the grave is empty, Lord. So we just give You thanks and praise. We ask for discernment into a deeper relationship with You, a deeper knowledge of Your incredible love for us this morning. As we read through Your scriptures, Lord, may they impact our hearts, and may they sink deep in, and may we remember them all of our days, God, as we just follow You and we trust You, Jesus. Be glorified in us, and Holy Spirit, fall on this place and give us a fresh baptism in Your name, Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Yeah, for His joy, He endured the cross. And He did that because He knew, and it was for His joy because He knew that many sons and daughters would be called to the kingdom of God through it. Yeah, He knew that you were going to be saved before you ever knew you were going to be saved. Praise God. And so He led us in that. He led us through that suffering, right, so that we could be connected with God. And it was fitting for Him, for whom all things and whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, the scriptures say, to make the captain of our salvation perfect through sufferings. Yes. And it's like, what? What does that even mean? You know, He's the captain of our salvation through sufferings. Does that mean we suffer? Yes, it means we suffer. And I know that right now in our culture and in this world, there's a lot of suffering going on. And there's a lot of hard things going on. And it is Easter Sunday, but that doesn't stop hard things from happening, does it? No, it doesn't. And the thing is this, is Jesus suffered greatly in His life. They called Him the suffering servant in the scriptures. And He was born to die. Yes, they literally gave Him frankincense. If you remember, one of the wise men brought frankincense to Him, knowing in premonition, in prophetically declaring that He was going to die for our sins. You know, He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, right? And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him, the scriptures say. So Jesus was God. He could have done anything he wanted to, but he laid down his rights to himself that he could be fully God, yet fully man. And so why did Jesus have to suffer if he's God? Because he laid down the rights to himself. And, you know, theologically, that's true. And theologically, because he loves us, of course, like crazy, and he'd do anything for us. But the thing is this, even die for us, amen. But really, truly, you know, on a very personal level, he suffered because we suffer. And he knew that we were going to suffer. And he knew that we were going to go through hard times. He knew we were going to have to deal with hard things. We knew the weight of the world. He knew that the weight of the world would be pressing in on our hearts, you know. And in suffering, in being the leading us, being the captain of our salvation through suffering, all of a sudden he can relate to us now. We have a God that can relate to us. It says in Hebrews 4, seeing then that we have a high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in our times of need. Amen. Yes, praise God, man. We have a high priest who can relate to us. The children of Israel always had to have a man intercede between them and God because they were sinful, and they're like, don't let us stand in the presence of God. You know, we'll get burnt up. And so God had set up a system where the descendants of Aaron and Moses, from the Levitical tribe, would be the priests who would intercede for the people. And we have the same high priest, but our high priest sits in heaven, and his name is Jesus Christ. Amen? Yeah. Yeah, praise the Lord that we have an advocate in heaven. You know why? Because he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Still, even though we have an advocate in heaven, we still suffer. We still go through life, and we still experience suffering, and we still, you know, just flounder in our lives many times, and we begin to ask God, why? Why are things so heavy, and you know, why do I pay so much in taxes this month? And why does everything seem to just get broken in time, and why am I continually taking care of things, and continually it keeps breaking, and we begin to say, you know, why? It seems like life is just futility, and no matter how far I get, everything just goes back to where it was, and nothing lasts, and everything dissipates, and pain is unavoidable. No matter what, I go through pain in family, in my relationships, when I go to work, in the different jobs I might do, or getting older. Amen. if you're getting older out there, I found that after I got past 50, yes, I'm suffering a lot more than I used to, you know? And then, of course, our taxes, you know, and they knew what it was like to be taxed, too. They were taxed 50-60% with all the Herodian taxes, and then the Roman taxes, and the temple taxes, and the tithes that they paid. They knew what suffering was, too, back then. And so the government and everything and all the oppression that falls upon us, man. But what it does is all those things are not bad when we're in Jesus Christ, because he works in all things for the good of those that love him and are called according to his purposes. Amen. What it does is it presses us like a wine press that squeezes out the first wine. And wine is always a symbol of joy. Squeezes us out so that we give up on the world and we say, God, the world just has nothing for me. I'm reaching out to something solid. I'm reaching out to you, Jesus. And we hold on to something solid, something eternal, something that lasts, something that's good, something that is always going to be there for us, even after we step out of these bodies, you know, something that transcends the monotony of everyday life, you know, shattering the reality of this world, making us realize that this life is not reality. Eternity is reality. Eternity is where we're going to spend all of our existence in, and we're just going to be in this life for a very short time. And you know, we hear this, and we know that to the world, the message of the cross is foolishness to those that are perishing. They're like, oh yeah, right, whatever, man, whatever, Pastor Sean, right? But to us who are being renewed, for us that are being saved, it is the power of God. It is the power of God. It gives us the ability to overcome anything that comes against us in this world. And that's just like God, you know, that he would take anything that comes against us in our life and turn it around and use it for our good, because he's good, and because he's with us, and because he leads us. And if he brings us to it, he's going to bring us through it. Amen? Yes, he takes the cross, and he takes the tomb, the things that nobody wants to think about, that are despised, that are pictures of death and its smell, and are just nothing that anybody wants to be around, and he turns them around and brings them as a symbol of hope, a symbol of hope. I saw necklaces this year where it has the open cross, the open tomb, or the open tomb on the necklace, and I was like, that is so cool, man. You know, because it's like taking these symbols to the world that mean death, and to us they mean that he's alive forevermore because he is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. And he takes death and he brings life, because our God can, and he's the only one that can. He takes despair, where we think that, oh, there's nothing good that's ever going to happen to me again because this has happened. And he takes that despair and he gives us hope. Beyond what we can see, beyond what we can know, beyond what we could even hope for. And our sins are forgiven on the cross once and for all. That he has paid the price, that you don't need to mea culpa and beat your back and walk on your knees to church this morning. Praise God. Amen. Because a lot of you have on really nice clothes. But the thing is, it's like our sins are paid in full by Jesus Christ once and for all over 2,000 years ago. Praise God. Say, my sins are forgiven.
My sins are forgiven.
And they are, once you have received Jesus Christ by faith. As a matter of fact, it says that he paid for the sins of the world. So your sins are already forgiven. It's just a matter of just receiving Jesus for it. It's just waiting for you. And why would God do such a thing? Why would God take everything in the natural order of things that he set up and break it and do something else? You know? Well, first, he knows that we're fallen by nature, you know. He knows that there's nothing that we have to be taught when we're little kids to hit the other kid in the head with the toy and take his toy. You know, just go check it out, man. They're doing it right now, probably. You know what I mean? They're just beautiful little sinners, aren't they? Yes. But we're the same way, you know, we're just sinners by nature through the line of Adam. But he made a plan long ago. Long before we were ever here, long before the first man Adam ever stepped on this planet. He made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his kind intention that he purposed in him, Jesus, with a view to an administration suitable to the fullness of times. That is the summing up of all things in Christ, things in the heavens and things on the earth. And so he made this plan, he made this administration, and it's like, why would he make an administration before he ever made anything else for our redemption, so that we could spend eternity in heaven with God? Well, I'll tell you, it's really easy. It's because he loves you. He loves you like crazy. He loves you as much as his own son, Jesus Christ. And you're like, I find that hard to believe. You know, Jesus was perfect. I'm not perfect. And it's like, we all know, right? Especially me. But the thing is this, is Jesus, God sees us as perfect, because once we receive Jesus Christ by faith, he already sees us as seated in the heavenlies with him. Praise God, man. And he knew that we were going to fall, so he came to us and he reached down to us. God demonstrates his love to us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Yeah, you didn't do anything good to be saved. Nothing at all. As a matter of fact, it was in our depravity of our sin is when God said, that one's mine. That one's mine. And he pulled us up and out of the miry clay. Amen? Yes. And it says here in John 3:16, but I'm also going to go to 3:17 because it's not as well repeated as a verse, but it is just as authoritative. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but will have eternal life. But it continues on. It says, for God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Yeah, see, you know, God, knowing that our default by the nature of us being sinners is that we spend eternity in a place called hell without God. And he knew that already, and he already made the administration long before any of us ever existed. Because just by our nature, we go to this place that's separated from God, because God is perfection and we're not perfect, so therefore we're cast out of the presence of God. So God said, I'm going to make a way for them since they can't make a way for themselves. I saw a thing on social media that says, why would I want to follow a God that sends people to hell? Hey, God isn't sending anybody to hell. We choose hell ourselves by not choosing God, because he has made a way for us to save us through the cross and the empty tomb. Amen. Praise God that he reached out to us, man. Knowing that by default, our place is a torment forever, separated from God, God reached out to us and saved us by dying on the cross and by rising from the grave. Amen. Yes. Praise the Lord, man. Because he is risen. Yes. And in that, he gave proof forever, for all of eternity, that Jesus is who he says he is. Amen. Yes. And that there is a resurrection, that there is a hope, that there is life beyond this life, that death is not the end, that it's only the beginning. Amen. And it is good, because it's like, we need that, man. In a world of continually being distracted by things and 1,000 different things coming in our phone at the same time that we could view, it's good that we could set our mind on the one thing that matters most, and that is Jesus Christ and his love for us. That we would not be distracted, that our mind would be focused and strong in the Lord. Amen. In 1 Peter 1:3, it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not go away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice. Yeah, greatly rejoice. And that's what we've come here today to do, amen, is rejoice in Jesus' name. So praise God, man, because our hope is alive. Yes, our hope is alive. It didn't just happen 2,000 years ago. He's here with us now. That's right. Praise God. And the cool thing about it is he's never been separate from you. Even before you were a believer, if you remember what that was, then he was still around you and guiding you and showing you things so that you might see and receive his goodness, man. Squeezing us out, using the things and pressures of this world, right? All the suffering that comes from this world pressing on us, causing us to reach forward and grab hold of him, squeezing out our wine, right, that we might have joy. And you know, you could go anywhere in the world, man. You could go anywhere in the world and visit other spiritual leaders' graves or tombs or all these different things. You can't go to Jesus's tomb. Yeah, that's right. They do have a tomb in Jerusalem, but that isn't the tomb that he was actually buried in. They don't know which one it is. It's just a representation. But the thing is this, it's because he's not in it. Praise God, man. Our God has risen and he is with us, man. And we can know that we could have hope beyond what we can see, beyond what we think, beyond what we think is going to happen. We can know even past the 12 o'clock hour when we think it has to be done, God is still God and God is still able. Amen. Praise God. Incorruptible, man. Yes. It says here, and I'll close in the scripture here, because I want to share something with you guys on baptisms. A worship team, you can make your way back up here. We're going to do a short song, and then I'm going to teach you guys on baptisms before we baptize. Because baptisms is a perfect object lessons for Resurrection Sunday. Amen. The water in the baptisms is simply a symbol of being buried with Jesus, going underneath the water and being resurrected back to life, coming up out of the water. So that's why we baptize every Easter, because it's a perfect lead-in for the teaching of Jesus Christ and the resurrection. In 1 Peter 1, it says, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conducts received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without blemish or without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believed in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Yeah, we were never designed to put our hope and our faith in this world, man. We were never designed to do that. Yeah, that's not how we're made. We're made in God's image. We're made for the incorruptible. We have an eternal spirit in us. We have a soul that gives us our identity. And in that, you know, it goes on forever, even past the sepulcher of death. We could know by putting our faith and hope in Jesus Christ that he did rise from the grave, that he did die on the cross for our sins, and that we could receive that by faith, and by that faith that we are saved. Praise God. I prayed to receive Jesus 24, 25 years ago, and it changed my life altogether once and for all. Had a man come to me and tell me, hey, I could choose to receive Jesus Christ by faith and be saved. I never had anybody tell me that in the streets. Like, you know, and then all of a sudden, everything changed for me. My thought process, my heart, everything. He takes our old stony heart and he gives us a heart of flesh, amen, that we could be feel and be sensitive. It's like, I cry over cat commercials now. Come on. It's ridiculous, you know. But we were never designed, you know, to put our hope in the world and the things we have in our jobs and or even into the peoples of our families. We're meant to put our hope into God. That's what we're designed for. And that's where our strength is. He is our strength. He is our ability to overcome. He has everything for us. He has everything for you. Hey, if you came in here this morning and you can honestly say, I don't really know where I'm going to go if I die today, I want you to know, as sure as Jesus Christ rose from the grave, that you can know for a fact that you're going to heaven today, because Jesus Christ has died on the cross for your sins and he has risen from the grave. Yes, praise God. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the grave, you will be saved, the scriptures say. And he saves all who call upon his name. It doesn't matter if you're rich. It doesn't matter if you're poor. It doesn't matter if you're old. It doesn't matter if you're young. It doesn't matter if you have extreme talents or you think you have no talents. It doesn't matter. God uses you and loves you just the way you are right now. Yes, he's good like that. So if you would like to know you're going for heaven for sure, please pray this prayer with me and know you're going. Not because of anything you did or are going to do, but because what Jesus did and because he loves you. And if you have fallen away from God and you feel like you've been far from God, then please pray this prayer with me as well so that you can have a fresh new walk with the Lord. And if you've already been doing all that, then please, you could pray out loud as well to encourage those around you, or you could sit silently and pray for those hearts that are receiving, for it is an act of the Holy Spirit, amen? Okay, let's do it. Repeat after me. I know that I have sinned, but Jesus, you died on the cross. On the third day, you rose again to give me new life in a relationship with you. Now help me and fill me with the Holy Spirit that I would follow you all the days of my life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the resurrection in me. Amen. Praise the Lord. I love you guys. God bless you guys. Stick around. We're going to teach on baptisms for a second. We're going to do a short song, teach on baptisms, and we're going to start baptizing. It's going to be awesome. Love you guys.
Feel free to stand. Feel free to sit. I always encourage us, the body, whatever's going to allow you to be the most centered and focused on Jesus in this time. Amen.
So now we begin the baptism portion of our service today. You can sit down if you like. Why do we do a full water baptism? Well, it teaches us to in the Bible, for one. But because why be baptized at all if salvation is done by the finished works of Jesus Christ? Amen? Because he did all the work, and receiving him as Lord is what saves us. You know, but we are baptized in the Spirit unto salvation. So we all go through a baptism when we decide to choose Jesus Christ by faith as our Lord and Savior. You know, for by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, the scriptures say in 1 Corinthians 12. And in Ephesians 1 it says, in him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also having believed you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. He is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. So water baptisms, they don't save us, but they are an act of our faith. They're an act that we submit to what God tells us to do. You know, they're proof of it. And if baptism saved us, then we'd be earning our own salvation, amen? And that's just ridiculous. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. This is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no man can boast. Yeah, so why be baptized? Because Jesus said so, amen? Yes, it's an act of our faith, it's submission. And Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me under heaven. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. And lo, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Yes, baptisms don't save us, but they are what saved people do. Praise God. They publicly declare that we are the Lord's. And Jesus was baptized by his cousin John. Even Jesus was baptized publicly. It says in Matthew chapter 3, then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me? And Jesus replied, let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this thing to fulfill all righteousness. Then John consented. Yeah, they don't save us, but they're crucial in our lives. They're a critical event in the life of a believer. A picture of Jesus Christ, his death going underneath the water and into the tomb, and the resurrection coming up out of the water, because he is risen.
He is risen.
Having been buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God, whom raised him from the dead. We get to make a public declaration that we are his. It is so good. Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized in Jesus Christ were baptized unto death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that Jesus Christ was raised, as he was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Yeah, praise God. We're only set free from sin and shame in Jesus' name. It's only by him and his finished works. So therefore, there is no more condemnation. There's no more guilt. There's no more of that suffering that comes from knowing that you think you have things looming over you because God has redeemed you. You can let go of the past and reach forward for the goodness and the future that he has for you. And you know, Jesus himself didn't even start his faith-based ministry until after he was baptized and everything was perfectly in order. Peter at the Pentecost implies a gift through baptism when he says, Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. So if you feel a dryness in your walk and you've been a believer for a while, please be baptized. Have a fresh newness and declare that you're the Lord's. If you're lacking in power and it seems like your past just keeps dragging you back and you just keep returning to the same things, be baptized and be renewed in his power and in his spirit. You know, when I was a new believer, I was baptized a few years after I confessed that Jesus Christ was my Lord. And the day I was baptized was the day that God gave me supernatural strength to overcome a lot of different sins in my life that I had carried with me all of my life. Praise God. So there is power in it too, you know, and baptisms are for new believers. They're for old believers. They're for first time believers or recommitments. They're for everybody. Okay, they're for the young and the old. Jesus said, let the children come to him. If you have kids that want to be baptized, please, we'd love to baptize your children. You know, and rejoice in what Jesus has done for you. Amen. Repent and be baptized, the scriptures say, because he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Yes, be refreshed and empowered in the waters. Yes, renew your sense of purpose and follow Jesus all of your days. Be baptized in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's move on to the baptism portion. I actually get to baptize my mother today. Praise God. Yeah. She's going to be the first one. So I hope you guys don't see my tears through the water. Praise God. All right, let's do it.
will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out, though in my soul cries.
In faith, so my life you have been so good with every breath that I am in. Oh, I will see the goodness of God. Goodness is running out, he's running out to me. Your goodness is running out, he's running out to me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendering now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running out, he's running out to me. Your goodness is running out. Thank you, Jesus.
So my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I make, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, so my life. The goodness of God.